In this figure, we want to talk about receptive fields of sensory neurons, as well as whether they converge or don't converge onto secondary sensory neurons. Okay, so receptive fields, first of all, are the spatial area to which a particular receptor is sensitive. In other words, in A here, we have a scenario where we have small receptive fields. In other words, this shaded area here of each neuron, right, is the area to which it will be receptive to a stimulus. And if we think of these as tactile in this scenario, let's think of these as tactile receptors in your skin, right? In this case, each of these individual receptive fields from these individual sensory neurons can respond to stimuli separately. And because they are non-converging, in other words, these neurons are staying, keeping their information separate from those adjacent to it, right? Each innervating their own secondary neurons. That means that we have very good point discrimination, right? A stimulus that arrives onto this sensory neuron, its receptive field versus one that hits this receptive field will be processed as distinct information by the central nervous system. And we get very good point discrimination, meaning we can tell the two apart on the surface of our skin. If we come over here into B, we have much larger receptive fields now. They're again non-converging. But what this means is that a stimulus that arrives and hits this guy here and hits the same neuron, a separate stimulus that hits the same receptive field over to the right, we can't tell the difference. Right? They're about equidistant as they were in A. The stimuli are about the same distance apart. But in this case, they were both stimulating the same neuron. They will be processed as a singular point of input. Right? We won't be able to tell that these are two separate stimuli. So large receptive fields tend to reduce our point discrimination. And sometimes we just don't need that. Right? We want small receptive fields and good point discrimination on the surface of our fingers or on our face, but we don't need the same sort of detail in sensory input in the middle of our back or on the side of our leg, right? So it's just reducing the amount of sensory input needed for functioning. Now in C down here, we have small receptive fields again, but in this case, they're converging. They're coming together on a single secondary neuron. And what this means is that a stimulus that arrives over here and a stimulus that arrives over here will not be distinguished as separate stimuli because, again, they're funneling together onto the single neuron here. This is very common in the peripheral retina of the eye on photoreceptor cells known as rods. The advantage to this is that what's happening, we get these multiple stimuli coming in, but they're being funneled together. Well, what's happening is they're being additive. Their inputs are being additive to this secondary neuron. And that makes the converging rods a very sensitive system to light input, right? Very good in low light levels. In D, we have another scenario where we have overlapping receptive fields, right? And we have a stimulus coming in here, and it's hitting both of these receptive fields. However, it's hitting one in the middle and it's hitting one over to the side, right? This one that's sort of shown underneath is being hit in its periphery of the receptive field. And what that means is that the two neurons are going to respond differently to that input. And what that helps with is it helps with point discrimination because our central nervous system knows that one is being strongly stimulated, another is being sort of weakly stimulated, but the combination of the two together gives us a little bit better point discrimination.